William Steel is a son of Brooklyn, New York. Throughout his lifetime, William has a knack for meeting people from all walks of life, both positive and negative, including the bizarre, the depraved, the wealthy, and people who are, undoubtedly, extraordinarily dangerous. How does William Steel cope with all of the tragedies that he's been exposed to? For William Steel, writing true crime memoirs is a cathartic release. Combined with his staunch victim advocacy, William Steel strives to be a protector of the vulnerable and a voice for victims terrorized into silence. William Steel is one to watch as an up-and-comer in the advocacy arena.
What a great movie, and I'm thrilled to have run into him here, and who knows, we might do something together.
Thank you.
Now keep watching, because my drama series, my movie about my life is coming out, and we already have the strip, and we're trying to go into pre-production and start doing some casting.
And I'm going to play him.
He's going to play me.
Yeah, because I know all about his life.
This guy, what do I do?
Thank you again for sharing your Sunday night with me, and please remember to smash that like and subscribe button and post a shout or two during the show. Let's get the chats up so we can hear you and hear your responses for my guest. So tonight, you know, tonight's going to be a different type of show, an interesting and informative show. My guest, a former prolific jewel and art thief who spent 18 years incarcerated for nonviolent crimes. He has rubbed shoulders with some of the most notorious criminals, including Jeffrey Epstein, Robert Durst, and many others. Today, he's a rising true crime author. He has appeared on Inmate to Roommate docuseries, and he's a crime victims advocate, too, that is helping those who have been wrongfully convicted. So please welcome author, reality star, and podcaster, William Steel, to Buzz Talk Live. How you doing, William?
How are you? You have a nice setup for your show. I love it.
Oh, thank you, buddy. And you too. I love your background, and it really pops. It really does. It really pops there. So.
Learning how to edit too. So.
Yeah. Yeah, on the speed course of life, as they say. Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Hey, you know, a lot of my shows are built around entertainment, and I you know, this show is more of a little bit of both. It's entertainment, it's information, it's life stories, and like yourself, you have one hell of a life story. You know, just doing some research on you and your background, as like I said, a prolific jewel thief and art thief as well. But you know, when you were growing up, you grew up in Brooklyn, right?
Yes. Yep. Brooklyn, New York.
So you're originally from New York, in Gravesend, I believe it was, right?
Yep. Gravesend, Bensonhurst. Yep.
Yeah. So you know, it's not every day that, you know, I interview a criminal that did his time, and now he's you know, on a rebirth, as they say, in life, and doing good and advocating for others. But you know, take me back when you were growing up, and I know that, you know, you hung out with the wrong crowd and all that, but what led you down that path?
I grew up in Brooklyn, and my mother was mentally ill, so I was exposed to a lot of that, defending her from bullies and stuff like that, and visiting her in psychiatric hospitals, and just dealt with a whole lot of drama in my childhood. And mm-hmm. I always wanted to be the guy to try to defend people and do the right thing. And I went south years later. But before I went south, I saw an advertisement for the New York School of Locksmithing Safes and Alarms. I wanted to be a James Bond type. I was in love with, Mission Impossible, Peter Graves, and all those shows.
Right.
You know, and I wanted to, you know, maybe work with the CIA or something, you know, just do something to help people.
Sure.
And so I went to that school, graduated top of my class, learned how to open safes, vaults, pick locks, install locks, security systems. And I've used some of that, opened up a company in Brooklyn doing security systems and locks, and did a lot of locksmithing and alarms in the World Trade Center, lower Manhattan, around Manhattan. And during this period, I decided to kind of veer off into real estate. And my best friend died in a car crash where I was supposed to be the driver. And I don't drink. I don't use any kind of drugs at all, you know. And some friends the next day, I was very depressed. They offered me coke. And I ended up getting over my head with this cocaine. And so I started perverting my skills with the locksmithing and alarms. And I started doing multi-million dollar burglaries all across the United States, South Florida, Las Vegas, Laguna Beach, you know, California, Beverly Hills, just all over the place.
Really?
And I'm not proud of it, you know, but, you know, I was really stuck on this cocaine binge thing for a long time. But I also got involved in South Florida with trafficking kilos and guns from South Florida to New York. So I pretty much had a steady supply of you know, all the coke I wanted at that time.
Right.
I tell my stories today as a motivational speaker and to people to try to, you know, use my story, turning my life around to help people. I have all kinds of haters and people say disgusting things about me and not, you know, encouraging, but I mostly have a lot of love and support from really, really good people that understand that the struggle and the journey and the emotional drama that I've been through. And so that's where I am today. I'm trying to use my past to help people today.
Well, I mean, look, you know, just going back to what you said about your friend dying in a car accident and you were supposed to be the driver, that right there is a tell because, you know, talk about being depressed and knowing that you should have been in that car and that could have been you and all that. And I can understand, you know, going down the path you did because of depression and everything, it really leads you to maybe taking a wrong turn, you know, and going on a drug binge like you did. But as far as you know, getting into the other life of thievery and taking from others and stuff like that, what triggered you to do that though? I mean, like, you know, as far as like stealing from others and all that, was it because of the depression, because of the drugs? Walk me through that part.
Pretty much, I think it was because I was working in real estate and I kind of let my security company shut down and I was kind of, in those days, it was the 80s and I started losing weight. It became noticeable to my broker and people in the office and my family. Mm-hmm. And I was, you know, pretty ashamed of what I was doing. You know, I wasn't proud of the fact that I was having this pretty bad struggle with coke.
Right.
A lot of people have dealt with years ago. So I haven't touched it now in like almost 25 years, but, So when I went through that, I just figured, you know, rather than going into work, I could use my skills and I was making money, you know, using picking locks and, you know, breaking into things. And, you know, one of the things I used to do was pose as Donna Karen's brother and go to open houses and work with realtors and see these multi-million dollar mansions all over the place and get the floor plans. And then I go back and hit the safe, get the artwork, whatever.
Really?
And now I really just do a lot of crime prevention shows. William Steel True Crime is on Rumble and on YouTube. Right. And so we do a lot of shows. We'll try to help do crime prevention now.
And we're gonna get to all that because, like I said, you know, after being incarcerated for 18 years, you really, you know, you turned your life around, and I commend you for that because it's amazing that, you know, I mean, I can just imagine, you know, being in prison all those years, and you missed out. We missed out on the technology, which you're getting ramped up right now. The speed courses on Zoom and doing your podcast but when you were taking from others, how are you fencing your stuff? Like where, like, you know, your jewels and your art and stuff. Like who are you? I mean, unless you don't want to talk about it, I can totally understand.
name names, but like in Manhattan, you know, you have the Diamond District. I had a lot of fences there.
Right.
In South Florida, you have the Siebold Building in Miami. And there's so many people that would just buy stolen jewelry there. You know, they don't care. I had a fence, another fence on in Palm Beach on Worth Avenue, which is actually where I met Epstein originally. And yeah, so then I had other ones in Vegas. Then I had a guy in South Florida. He was actually a former detective in New York who was corrupt.
Right.
And he was buying a lot of stuff from me. Other times I might go into a jewelry store. Like if I was in a new town, I might bring something like the necklace I have on and say, you know, hey, you know, I'd buy something first, maybe get them comfortable, spend $100, $1,000, and then I'd go back and say, hey, you know, my aunt, you know, needs, we're gonna do an insurance claim. You know, can I sell you that jewelry from her house, sight unseen, no ID?
Right.
Sure, bring it in, I'll give you the best price. And once I know they're willing to cross that line,
I could
continue.
That was your in. Yeah, yeah.
So I had a lot of jewelers and stuff that I would work with, and it pretty much they all knew where it was coming from.
Wow. So talk to me about life in prison. I mean, 18 years being locked up and being, away from family and everything, and your mother being mentally ill, as you said. Was your family visiting you, and did your mom, you know about what has happened to you and all that?
My mother was not well, and you know, she would always say, William, tell them you're innocent. You know, even no matter how many years I was locked up, she would always say that. And then I had two sisters step in and then do me the favor of telling her that I was dead. You know, so my sisters, you know, I have the proof, so I don't really care about saying it in public. I forgive them. But they told her I was dead. They had her sign a trust agreement, leaving them everything. And I lost, my relationship with my mother because of my sisters. And they stole about $800,000 from me in inheritance before I got out of prison. Yeah, I've been lying to my mom. And, you know,
That's awful.
Those relationships are not there anymore. And I really could care less because, you know what?
I hear you.
I forgive them, but. Right. I don't have to deal with them anymore.
Right. No. As you're, you know, serving your sentence and everything, and again, you know, for nonviolent crimes, but did you take up writing? Did you start writing your books or a book in prison? And did that come to fruition afterwards? How did that work?
Well, I started writing the book about Robert Durst, Sex and the Serial Killer, my bizarre times with Robert Durst. I knew Robert Durst. That's actually the old cover. There's a new cover now. But that was featured on Inmate to Roommate. And, you know, we have like 12.3 million just on TikTok on that reality show.
Right.
So this book here was written by him. The new cover, it has the shout out by Nancy Grace on the cover. Nancy Grace covered this book on her podcast while I was still incarcerated. And it shot up. I've been in the National Enquirer, the New York Post, a lot of these publications.
Hmm. So talk to me about Inmate to Roommate, with you being part of that show. So again, if no one's watched the show, it basically profiles a prisoner being let out, and a family basically takes them in. After their sentence and tries to, ease them back into society and whatnot.
Right.
But how did that happen? I mean, you were incarcerated. So how did that happen?
Well, the same people that made Sharp Entertainment, they made Love After Lockup, 90 Day Fiancé. This show is basically a spinoff of Love After Lockup. Like you said, it's where people that are not your family agree to let you live with them after you're in prison. So in my case, I had a falling out with family, as I just explained to you. And my pen pal, been writing to her for 6 years. She said I can go to Indiana to stay with her family to get on my feet and all that. I was going to go back to South Florida or New York City. But so right around that time, A&E stepped in and said, hey, would you like to take part in this reality show, docuseries about getting on your feet after incarceration? I said, yes, but only if I'm allowed to talk about my faith and my new journey and my books and stuff like that. And they agreed. And it was pretty cool. And
good.
And the show shot up to be the second highest rated reality show in the United States.
Yeah, I know. I saw that. That's incredible. We do have a clip, but the first clip I want to show is when you get out of prison and you meet up with what's the woman's name, Shama or something?
Shauna,
yeah. So she meets you and she takes and she starts to take you in. So let's run that first clip from season one of Inmate to Roommate.
Is it him? I'm very excited. Bill and I, we just built a really good relationship, a really good friendship through writing letters back and forth, and I'm anxious to meet him.
After all these years, hi Bill.
Hi.
I've been waiting forever. I didn't think you were ever coming out. I've been here like 3 hours.
Oh. Been here like 18 years.
Oh, okay.
I'm feeling like I could fly. It feels surreal, just completely overwhelming. First thing I want to do right now is get as far away from this prison as possible and then just put this in the rearview mirror permanently.
On to better things.
Yes, free at last.
I feel an incredible feeling of optimism and joy that after 18 years, massive chunk of my life gone, I am finally free. I'm just extraordinarily grateful for Mark and Shauna that they opened their home to me. It's very humbling, the trust that they put in me in doing that, and that's more of encouragement for me to do the right thing, and I'm just so grateful for it.
Wow. You know, that's crazy that this person that was your pen pal in prison, meeting you for the first time on the road like that, talk about bravery. I mean, because she didn't know what to expect. But I guess, you know, spending the time that you did writing back and forth to her, you know, she gained trust, you know, through your writings and through your relationship that you had with her in prison. I have a second clip now. The second clip I show is when you get locked out. And you get locked out of the house. And
that being said, let me say something about Shauna. So,
oh yeah,
as time progressed and her husband would go to work, I'd get the knock on the door at nighttime. Bill, can we talk?
Oh.
So, yeah, it kind of went south, and I didn't know that she wanted to be with me. And you got to watch the show.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, my fiance is extremely beautiful and highly competent, and I wasn't feeling Shauna one bit like that. And we had written each other platonic letters over the years.
Wow.
And she, you know, you have to watch the show, but it gets crazy. It's extremely funny. I try to be appropriate because I did appreciate them opening their doors to me.
Sure.
But they end up just treating me like so much, you know, crap that it was ridiculous.
Well, it was the husband. I didn't catch his name, but it was the husband that,
Mark,
yeah. Right. That, you know, he didn't trust you. You picked up on it right away. Yeah, he didn't trust you. But let's watch the second clip.
Okay, they changed the locks. They guess they want to be here when I get here. So they must have changed the locks. They know I have my here, my computer here, all my paperwork's here, all my clothes are here, and they want to lock me out. Mark, Shauna.
I was a very, very notorious burglar. I was a locksmith, an alarm technician, and they know this. They know enough about my history. It's ironic that you would lock me out. I could pick the locks in seconds and come right in and help myself and, you know, be sitting at your dinner table when you come home and like, why'd you lock me out? You know, I'm capable of getting in. And I live here. I get mail here. It's my parole address. In an abundance of caution, because I'm so afraid of violating parole and getting in trouble, I said, let me not do that.
Hello?
Hey, Mark. Hey, it's Bill. Are you inside?
Well, we just left the ball game. We'll be there probably 25 minutes. So.
Okay. Hey, did you change the locks?
Yep.
Whenever I ever demonstrated to you, I couldn't be trusted.
I don't know, man. I mean, you can give it your best and go ahead and try to pick them. I don't know.
When you're dealing with creeps, you expect creepy, slimy, sneaky, and that's what I got. Welcome back to a locked house.
Yeah.
When have I ever showed you any reason to distrust me?
I'm like, oh, brother. Knowing that Bill was back, you know, increased my anxiety. I could instantly felt like a tightness in my stomach. You know, he didn't give us any notice. So I have no clue what we're walking into with Bill coming back.
No real concern for my love life when we've already had the understanding that if I had to move out, I'd be given a, you know, a week or two notice to get my together.
It's crazy, you know, and none of that was put on. That's true. He felt that way about you, and it came, and that, I guess that's why it was such a popular show, and it is a popular show. They're coming out with a second series, right? Isn't it dropping soon?
Only A&E Network knows when. I do know. What I can say is that it is coming out season two, and it's due like any time now, like really soon.
Wow. So, okay. So they
reserve the right to announce it first, though.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. I just want to say, if anybody's out there tuning in, if they have any thoughts that come to mind about Bill and his background, please chat away. We do have a Mary B. I believe that's your Mary. great job, William. Great job. Okay. Well, thanks. But yeah, if anybody else is out there watching and listening, please, if you have any questions, chat him in.
That's Mary. She's a data scientist, a forensic accountant. She works with me with cases that guys that are wrongfully convicted. She's been working in that space even before we met. And so I was a law clerk in prison. So if you know anybody who's wrongfully convicted or has a draconian lengthy sentence for a nonviolent crime, I was a law clerk for a very long time. Oh. I'd be more than happy to profile the case here and help with your attorneys or, you know, bring in publicity to your case.
That's good to know. That's good to know. I really want to pivot and I want to talk to you about your first book. I guess it was your first book, The Sex and the Serial Killer.
Yes.
Is that the first one? Susan Bergman. Now, she was your friend.
Yeah, I met her and Bobby, Robert Durst, on the same day in Manhattan. So we became friends. She confided a few things to me. And she was Dave DeJew Berman's daughter. He was a gangster in Las Vegas. She was a screenwriter and author. And Bobby down below, Robert Durst, his family is the Durst Organization in Manhattan. And they control billions of dollars of New York City real estate.
Wow.
And he was killing people. He's worth $100 million, or was, and killed Susan.
Wow. Wow. That's incredible. I mean, here you have a guy that's worth all that money and such a high-profile guy. And so, obviously, he was a psychopath and you know, and enough said about him.
You have read the book. A lot of stuff that I put in the book, I put out there before they even went public with anything. Like, he denied the cadaver letter that he wrote the Beverly Hills Police Department, that there was a body in the Beverly Hills house.
Really?
I put that in my book years before, and people that were involved with me said, oh, you're going to get sued over saying that. Really? I said, I don't care. That's what he told me. I know for a fact that he killed her. There was recordings made. He sent that letter. And then finally at the trial, he admits to sending the letter. But he said that he was going there for a staycation, walked in on her body, and then fled because Janine Pirro was after him, you know, for killing his wife in New York. So he admits it during the trial.
I didn't know 20 years later.
Oh, yeah. He admits it during the trial. Finally, after 20 years of lying, saying that he didn't write the cadaver letter.
Oh, my God. But how did
I put it in my book years before.
How did you meet Robert? Was it in...
I was attending the locksmithing school in New York on 42nd Street, and a friend of mine, we were rushing out, you know, from lunch from a restaurant, and I literally ran into him. My sword went all over both of us. He and I had some words. Susan kind of played peacemaker. She jumped in the middle of it. You know, at that time, I had kind of one foot in one life, one foot in another, but I was basically doing the right thing. You know, I was trying to be the good guy. You know, it wasn't
right. But you didn't know her. Before Robert, right? Or did you?
No, he introduced me. And if you see in the book, he approached me, probably other people as well, and said that, you know, we need to kill Susan. I said, who the hell is we? She's my friend. I'm not killing
So he
Susan.
Wanted you to be his hitman.
Yeah, I detail it in the book and where the tapes are and the photographs and all that stuff.
Interesting.
But Yep.
When the trial happened, were you in the courtroom? Were you there?
It was COVID still going on, so you had to let the clerk know and get a pass and all this nonsense. I was there. I spoke to the court TV people, the prosecutor, his lawyer. His lawyer knows me real well. Dick DeGaron is he represented David Koresh, Waco, and all that. So Dick DeGaron, he said to me, he screamed at me in front of the bailiffs when I showed up there. I had a couple of copies of the book I was handing out, and they wouldn't let us in the courtroom. But I saw Bobby sitting there in the wheelchair when he was on trial. But the bailiff said, "I'm sorry, but the clerk hasn't approved you guys to come in. You had to get like a pass a week in advance because of COVID." Wow. Britney Spears' trial was going on in another courthouse, and the things were packed in both courthouses. So I had some words with the lawyer. He yelled at me for something I put in the book, and then he apologized after his recess.
Wow.
"I'm sorry, you know, we talked privately, so yeah, I got photographed." Yeah.
Hey, we have a question. Somebody chatted in from I think it's truecorruption.com. A question for you, Bill, is we're hearing that Mary's being victimized by your acquaintance, Nicole, in Fort Wayne. I don't want to give the last name, but what's the status of that case?
Came to me. I try to vet cases of actual innocence and stuff before we put them on the show, because we had a doctor, Leslie Marlin Scholl, lie and claim he was entrapped and this, that, and the other thing. So this lady, woman, came, and then she wanted to have her brother's case profiled on the show. We looked it over. He's a career criminal. There was some possibility of brutality. But then she tried to trade me sexual favors to do some other stuff for her related to her case, to her brother's case, you know, for like research and documents and all that. And I was a law clerk, so they put a lot of demands on us. And then in the end, though, she and her mom had contracted to pay myself and Mary. But it was getting really ugly as far as like, you know, the comments that were being made. So yeah, she's victimized Mary. She threatened her with blackmail, extortion.
Really?
And, you know, that was recently. Yeah. So we try to vet these cases, you know, and then I can't really control what people say. And if I say something inappropriate, it could be taken way out of context or whatever. If I'm doing something and I know, like, for example, where we are, you can record anybody you want. You don't have to get permission. So when I know things are going south, for my safety, I'm making recordings, video, tracking my locations.
Absolutely.
And everything I say is staged to try to make sure that, you know, I could prove what the hell I'm trying to say later on.
Yeah.
But yeah, she tried to victimize Mary over this, and it's still going on as we speak.
I have a note here about Robert Wagner. Is it the Robert Wagner?
Yeah, Robert Wagner. Yeah, I can't really say much on here because I don't even know if he's still alive, is he?
I don't think so.
I don't know if he passed away.
I don't know if he did.
I met him years ago, and he made some, you know, comments about his ex-wife, Natalie Cole.
Right.
So we played in West Side Story and some other shows.
Huh. And, interesting.
You know, I'm not going to say what he said here, but it was very highly incriminating about what he did with her.
Oh boy, let's not go there. you know, I'll tell you, your books have been getting off the chart reviews, you know, really 4 or 5 star reviews, and people are saying that they can't put the book down. You know, they're true crime lovers of reading your stuff, and you know, that's kudos to you, man, and your background and how you really. You really turned your life around. That's awesome.
I appreciate it. I have several more books coming out. One is about crime prevention, protecting yourself from burglary and home invasion. Another one's my full autobiography. And another one is a faith-based book, like my faith journey.
Right.
You know, no matter what I did, I really felt that God was always had his hand on my life, protecting me from, because I've been shot at. I've been in really dicey situations.
Wow. Wow.
And he's brought me through on the other side. So
yeah, without a doubt, incredible life, man. Incredible life you're leading and you had. I mean, as far as now, I want to talk about Ghislaine Maxwell and your relationship with her, because you did have a relationship. Is it at the same time as Jeffrey Epstein, or was it separate times?
I actually met Epstein first at a diamond salon in Palm Beach. I was at a Fences Diamond Salon. I was a fugitive at the time. I was struggling but being wanted, and I was trying to sell, you know, about 200 grand worth of jewelry. And he's in the salon with his hand down the shorts of this young lady.
Oh, boy.
And I told my friend when he left, I said, hey, I'm going to lunch. I'll come back up later. I got some jewelry to show you. And I followed Epstein and this young lady to a restaurant. And that's, I confronted him. There was a gun involved. And so ultimately he talked his way out of the confrontation. And I ended up meeting Galen not long after that. So I had an unfortunate relationship with her before she became infamous. And at the Palm Beach mansion, and you see it in the book. The last time I got out of that house, I think I barely escaped with my life because of the circumstances.
Damn. Well, that was what year was that? Was it 2020 or was it no?
Exactly, 2005.
2019. Oh no, right. But when he
before
was
the, hot, before, heavy, the, when, before his first arrest, which he went only to the Palm Beach County Jail and for, you know, he's doing things with minors, and they wanted to say it was with prostitutes. Well, it's not a prostitute if she's underage. It's
so his rape of a man. Yeah, his little journey through crookedness, I guess, came early on when you met him, and then it just blossomed into, you know, the person that he eventually became. And Glenn,
evidently it's been going on for decades, and I was one of the few people that came forward years ago and gave evidence to authorities in Palm Beach County, and absolutely nothing was done with it. Nothing was done with what
is
I
that right?
And numerous of the girl victims had reported what was going on. Nothing was done. I think until one was taken serious or something.
Obviously, he was being protected, you know.
Definitely.
Yeah, you know, and Prince Andrew and Bill Clinton. I mean, all these people that eventually, you know, has the Lido Express, I guess they called it. You know, going to Epstein's Island. Incredible that you were actually part of that, you know, with Ghislaine and everything.
I've met so many because of my lifestyle. You know, I was always kind of pretending to be something I wasn't, which was in these upper echelon societies, Palm Beach, you know, California, Laguna Beach, Beverly Hills, spots in Vegas, because I wanted to be around, you know, very affluent and wealthy people in those years. You know, I deeply regret what I've done, but. And you learn who's got what as far as especially jewelry stores or these mega mansions or even criminals. You know, I prefer to actually rob a criminal's house. But so I was running in these circles, and I would, you know, if I'm in Palm Beach on Worth Avenue, who are you going to run into?
Right.
You're not going to run into, right. You know, blue collar people very often.
Exactly. Exactly. So the book is called Ghislaine, Sensational and Impure. That was the... Right. The book and yep. And Amazon, it's on Amazon, by the way. All these books you can purchase them on Amazon. There was a Netflix a docuseries, a mini series, Filthy Rich. I think it was in 2020 that I don't know how many episodes there were, but there is a trailer for this, and you were did you have anything to do with that?
I was asked to be a consultant on that. They didn't really use much of my material, but one of the trailers evidently has me on it, so I found that kind of fascinating.
Okay, so let's roll that.
My name is William Steel. So here I am, and I'm here to tell my story over 20 years later, putting the chains of my past behind me.
You're taught that predators are old men in alleys. You're not told that a friend, a socialite, a woman can be a predator too.
When Epstein was first arrested, it's hard to know why Maxwell was not arrested at the same time.
I met Maxwell and Epstein when I was just 16 years old through my sister, Maria Farmer. We were both abused, and I'm going to be testifying at her trial.
Without Ghislaine's help, Jeffrey Epstein could never have abused more than 500 victims.
I hope that Maxwell is held accountable for what she's done.
She basically played a role of a madame.
Class can cloud reality. And Ghislaine capitalized on that. She exhibits characteristics of a narcissist.
I believe that she didn't think she was doing anything wrong.
She knew she was going to make these high-powered men happy.
On a scale of shock, she'd be a great wife.
One of the most eagerly anticipated criminal trials.
She fed a monster. You had to kind of be a monster to do it.
Wow, that looks like a great series, man. No kidding.
To be clear, though, that series was not based on my book.
It's not. So you know. Right. No, it's definitely. get the book because the book it always tells, you know, the right story. And that's why the book is always better than the movie, right? Don't they always say that? The book, you got to give it to her. No, seriously.
I named one person in that book, and I mentioned her name on a friend show, Invest in Yourself. He had like 4 million views in 2 days before that individual or whatever TikTok shut down his show and then took that clip off. But then they put it back up. And so.
We just found out that Robert Wagner is alive. So he's 94 years old. So I misspoke there. So I just want to get that corrected.
And he's in a mansion, not a prison cell. Good figure.
And he's in a this is not the type of show to accuse or anything. I don't want to go there. But you know, you're a busy guy. You're writing books. You have a podcast, right? The true crime podcast.
I had one of your documentaries on there about Kim Kahana.
That's right.
Best stuntman ever lived.
That's right. And a short little program note: we're going to be in a festival this coming weekend in New Jersey at the International Motion Picture Film Festival. So if anybody's out there that is in the area that would like to come, there's tickets. You can either buy them at the door. Or you can go ahead, just go on my Facebook page, George Buzzio, and you can see the link there. That was a whole incredible experience in my life, Bill. I thank you so much for having me on to talk about the film and everything. It took 3 years, about 3 years now that all came to be, and now it's doing pretty well in the festivals. But Mr. Kahana, he's still alive and he's doing well, and he's such an inspirational person to all of us and to anyone he's met.
You know, John Wayne. I mean, who the heck has he had not worked with this guy?
Yeah, no.
So he's going to be on my show. I know you gave me the connection.
Oh, great, great.
He's to come on. So I want to mention also, I just filmed a movie in Florida called Silent Partners, Ciro DiPaggio film. He did Mob King. Silent Partners will be in theaters and streaming this summer. And we're looking to do some more things together, plus a drama series and film about my life, hopefully, within the next year or so.
Yeah.
It's
funny you mentioned Ciro DiPaggio because we have a clip of Silent Partners. So let's run that.
Frankie Cuts. Oh, brother. Which brings us to business. Who's this bedbug? He's talking to himself, man. I got tired of splitting the pie 16 different ways up north. New York, Chicago, Tampa, they all got their own thing. This is our thing.
Goody Boy Financial.
What are you, nuts? You want me to sign this paperwork so that in case something happens to me, the money goes to Al DeLuca? Absolutely not, man.
Okay, all right, take it easy.
Now, if I decide to take off on a crazy cocaine binge with a bunch of Asian hookers and unexpectedly die of a massive heart attack, they still get their money.
The mastermind behind Goody Boy is none other than the original head snake of the American Mafia.
That's right. Meyer fucking Lansky.
They say I own half of Monte Carlo.
So how did I get here with this guy? I clicked the wrong guy one day.
Lenny, get the fuck up! What are you doing?
I had to come babysit Koufax. And that's how I became Johnny Square Briefcase.
There's a shitstorm coming.
Who the fuck is Fat Dave?
I know these two black guys.
Y'all got the crackers up here, but y'all want to get a little greedy. Start eating everything up like them motherfucking raviolis over there.
I don't like when dogs bark in the house. Do I do the fucking dogs that bark in the house? I put them in a fucking cage, you understand?
You should have seen this cop. He had one eye looking at Wednesday, the other eye was looking at the weekend.
You still on the phone? Fuck, man.
Sales.
Wow, that looks good, man. And when is that coming out?
They just wrapped it a few weeks ago, and I'm being told that it will be out this summer, theaters and streaming.
Oh, wow. Okay, cool.
I went to the film festival in New York in December. It was Dances with Films. It wasn't fully filmed then. They aired some of it. And I can tell you, the movie was phenomenal, not just because I'm in it, because I didn't even get my part in it until after they needed more footage. But
a lot of wise guys are in there. I saw the cast. Yeah, it's great. It's,
you know, Mike Marino, man, that guy was so funny.
Yeah.
The guy that said he's looking out of one eye, he's doing this. he's got a show from my mother's basement or something in New Jersey, but he's also a comedian that travels the country. Mike Marino was so funny in that movie. I nearly died laughing.
Oh, God. Well, I'm going to have Gary Pastore on the show in June. So I know he's in the movie. I mean, look, you know, you've been so busy with your life and doing your podcast. You have a co-host that comes on every once in a while, Ignacio Esteban, right?
That's right.
And hopefully Ignacio is watching because he's going to come on my show too at a later point. But you talk about, you know, current political events that are happening, right? So you got the election
Ignacio is retired ATF, 30 years.
Oh,
ATF.
Yeah. That's right. That's right.
80 books. My other co-host is Meghan Markle's sister, Samantha. He's on occasionally.
Oh, okay.
And then I have Frank Lordy. He's a former commissioner in Ohio who got convicted of corruption. He wasn't corrupt. He got framed. Oh. And he just got exonerated recently. He's written a book called Framed Innocence.
Oh, wow.
And so these are my collection of co-hosts. I'm looking for a mafia expert. If you know somebody, send them my way. I need to do a mafia show on a regular basis.
Oh, a mafia show. Okay. I know some people, but not those kind of people.
I want to do some faith-based stuff too, because without God, that's my higher power.
Yeah. I'm not
my faith. I'm not perfect, man. I'm screwing up every day, you know, but I do count my faith as the main thing that helped me turn my life around.
Yeah, I mean, as far as your legacy is and doing what you're doing, what do you think your legacy will be? Were you throwing that at me?
No, I was trying to get somebody's attention. I'm on a blood thinner. I just started bleeding on my arm.
Oh, no way. Oh, yeah. No way.
I'm okay, but
I can't give you a Band-Aid, so if that's what you're asking, man.
Right.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm gonna live.
Okay, good.
I'm sorry, I just needed somebody's
attention. I guess that's your legacy, right? you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah. Right. No, I was just asking about your legacy, what your legacy will be. What you've done, you know, up to this point, your books, your podcast, your advocacy and all that.
Well, if I tell it, I'm going to sugarcoat it and give you the PR spin.
Well,
right?
I have to
maybe let my haters write it. And, you know, well, Bill's a hypocrite and he's a this and he's that and he's a con artist. I've been called all that stuff, you know, all the human being.
Well,
I'm not perfect. I try to let it roll off. But yeah. I'd like people to think that, you know, I tell people that when I close off my shows, you know, how do you want to be remembered? I'd like to be remembered for somebody, you know, makes a lot of mistakes in his life and turn a corner and actually in the end did more benefit than good.
Right. Keep the positives.
For other people, yeah.
And, you know, it's showing because of, the views, 11 million over, right? 11 million, 12 million views.
12.3 or something on
social.
TikTok.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I did TMZ with Harvey Levin. I think we had 8 million views on all platforms when he interviewed me for like 7 minutes. It was a very long interview. It was pretty cool being on TMZ.
You were also profiled on America's Most Wanted, too.
Yep. I escaped from prison and was never made it to the show. They were about to produce it, I guess, but it was on their website. My escape was nothing but spectacular.
Yeah, talk to me about your escape because that's hello.
Well, I escaped from prison numerous times, unfortunately, and it was really just to go out and have some fun for a little minute and then go back before count time. And then, so years later, I was in the same facility. I kind of knew the routine and I had a death in the family. I wasn't in my right mind. And we were actually working in the community and I took off. But because of my background, they took it very, very serious. They said, well, if this guy is in your neighborhood, I don't care if you live in a gated community, oceanfront, no one's safe if he goes back to doing what he knows best. So they took it real serious. And that's why, I got profiled. But it is what it is.
Yeah, I'm escaping.
But wait,
times.
There's more. So when people
there's more.
When people meet me and they've only seen the show and I start talking about my true crime show or TMZ or this and that, and then I'll kid around. I'll say, but wait, there's more. I was featured on America's Most Wanted. And,
right.
But wait, there's more.
It just keeps going with you. Incredible. But no, it's great that you came on, you stopped on Buzz Talk Live, and when is your next book coming out? Is there what do you need to pitch here? Come on, pitch me.
I'm not sure if you've ever written a book, but it's always a few weeks away, and I've been saying that for a few months now. So.
Right.
So I'm trying to step it up to get these next two out before season two of Inmate to Roommate drops. Needless to say, when a network show airs and they profile my first book,
right,
it really benefits sales. And so do these shows. And I appreciate it. Please check out the books when I'm up in New York. If you want to meet me when I'm up there, I'll let people know when I'm around.
Yeah.
I'll be happy to
autograph. Follow him on social and all that. Bill you're an inspiration, man, because of your past and because you've turned your life around now for the best. You're helping others, and I commend you for that, man. That's awesome.
I'm trying. It's a struggle. If anybody's out there praying, a praying person, man, I need prayer like anybody else, kinds of family drama and, health issues popped up here and there. I'm trying to hopefully everything's going to settle down, It's a real blessing just to be free. I don't take a day of my freedom for granted anymore, and I try to steer clear of anything remotely questionable.
Well, I commend you, and I wish you the best of luck. I really do.
George, it was great seeing you, and I thank you so much. I love the format of your show. You're a class act. You have a really well put together show. You have a wonderful show here. I like your editing style, too.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, editing on the fly.
That's okay. You've been doing it a while. I know you have a history of working with other shows, too.
I have a great engineer, technical engineer, Danny Guido, he's the best. He's the best there is.
I was on two other shows over there from that network. Cindy's show.
Okay.
I think it is what it is or something. I forget her name for show. And then Frank in Washington. I was on their show before.
I tell you, I really wish you were in studio here because it's a fantastic studio here at Paradise Studios in Massachusetts.